Yes, good morning, Chetan.
Morning, Ken.
Yes, thank you so much for another interview, the second round of interview.
Pleasure.
Yes, okay. Pleasure. Yes, I'd like to revisit a few points from the answers you've given.
Yeah.
Right. Could you tell us more about your cricket days?
Oh yeah, it was one of the best days of my life actually. Yes, I was passionately involved in cricket since probably I was 5 or 6.
Yes.
So, and that passion grew as I got older.
Yes.
And I started playing serious cricket during my high school days, and I was part of YMCA, and we played a lot of local tournaments.
Right.
I was exposed to Division One league of playing with some big players. So
yes.
I was fortunate to kind of have played with the likes of some of the established Indian cricketers at that time.
Oh right.
So there was a lot of tournaments which happened locally there called Sibaka Trophy, and I was named the best batsman under 14. I think it was in 1992-93.
I see.
And then, you know, like then the state selection, and then eventually it was under 16, and then so during those days the cricket was like literally worshipped, and it is still now in India. And probably every other child wanted to be playing for their nation and stuff like that, and I was no different.
Yes.
But as I grew, there was a lot of pressure from my family background as well.
Mm-hmm.
Not from directly from my parents, but mm-hmm. a lot of emphasis from the background I do come from was more towards education.
Yes.
So all my uncles and my family members, they're like double graduates and they've done their PhDs and stuff.
Yes.
And obviously my time playing cricket was really hampering my mainstream education.
I see.
So parents were really concerned about whether what I'll do and stuff like
oh.
that. At the same time, you know, like cricket was a very expensive game to pursue. So like for helmets and
yes.
for leather bat, you know, pads and bats and everything would cost an arm and a leg from a middle class family perspective. So those things also kind of was playing on my mind. So I really wanted to do well, but there was a time when I had to decide whether what should I do for the future.
Wow.
And then I had to take a call whether I'll really stick to cricket or kind of, you know,
retrain
myself partially and then start focusing on on my education.
I
think it was like 10th was the turning point for in our secondary education, because then you get on to 11th and 12th and stuff.
Right.
That time I really had to kind of bend my back and get the right numbers. If otherwise, then getting seat would be very difficult.
Yes.
But that's, yeah, I was 15 and 16 when I said, well, no, look, I have to focus more on education.
Right, I see.
And I decided to kind of...
Wonderful.
Yeah, so I didn't pursue much, but I did play for my university and stuff like that.
But
then the passion has already reduced.
Right.
Yeah, but one of the best days of my life is playing cricket.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
Can you share with us some of your encounters, personal encounters with some cricket stars? You know.
Yeah, absolutely. I would like to share one incident where I was fortunate to spend about 3 to 5 minutes with the best bowler of India called Anil Kumble.
Uh-huh.
So we had, at that point in time, actually, the state selection had just got completed, and they'd announced the results.
Yes.
And my name was not in top 15.
Uh-huh.
So as a young boy, I was very disappointed.
Yes.
And obviously there are many other political reasons why my name wasn't there.
I see.
The system, it was not very clean. It had its own political influence.
As in all sports, yeah.
Yeah. So my dad and I were walking out of the KSCA, Karnataka State Cricket Academy ground from Bangalore.
Mm-hmm.
And we saw this wonderful cricketer called Anil Kumble, and he was. And I said to my dad that he is Anil Kumble.
Uh-huh.
So my dad walked up to him and said, "Look, you know, my son is couldn't get selected, but he's quite disappointed." And Anil gave me a great advice. I said, "Look, follow cricket as your passion. It should always be a passion.
I see.
And it should not become your source of income at this point in time. So you should play cricket for your enjoyment.
I see.
There are a billion people in India.
Oh yes, yes.
Only 11 people can play for the country.
Yes.
So there's nothing for you to get disappointed.
Mm-hmm.
Keep your passion alive. Keep your enthusiasm alive.
Yep.
Don't get dejected and disappointed.
Mm-hmm.
Keep playing. If time arrives, then you'll be selected at one day and you'll play. It was a very good advice from someone who was that well established. He was very pragmatic and he spoke to us for about 3 to 5 minutes.
Wow.
But I still recall those
wonderful
moments. And
wonderful.
Yeah.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. I'm sure you do a lot of encouragement to your staff as well, and all these things will mean a lot of difference to them.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah,
yeah.
That's right. Okay, now the other thing is about your job's traveling job. I always envy, you know, people with, you know, father or mother who always have a job that is traveling around, right? But I'm sure there's a lot of disruption as well. But could you tell us a bit of those days, like where, places you've been, people you've met? Yeah.
Sure. My dad worked for nationalized bank called Karnataka Bank, actually.
I see.
So obviously, the job demanded him to kind of move locally within the state and in few occasions outside the state as well, where we lived.
Yes.
It had definitely pros and cons, because obviously you kind of would move every 3 years, and there are areas when you actually move which are sometimes are rural areas or not very urban, so it will hamper your education. So my dad and mom made that compromise. So my mother stayed with us in the areas where we could fetch good education or would get good education.
Right.
And my dad would then go to the rural areas and be there on his own.
Right.
So there was a lot of sacrifice from my parents' side in that, actually, to make sure that the kids get the best of education, because that was the most important thing in our families and stuff.
Yes.
So the rural areas, we would only travel probably once in a month to see our dad, and he would otherwise come and see us.
Uh-huh.
So, but we would almost talk every single day with the telephone
and
stuff like that.
Wow.
We're very close, emotionally attached family.
Yes.
But some of the areas where we could travel, we were actually in a small place called Tumkur.
Mm-hmm.
From Tumkur, we went to Bangalore and then to Mumbai, which is the commercial capital of India.
Yes.
Bombay now. And I think going to Bombay was the game changer from our perspective, because then Bombay exposed us to different league of people altogether, multilingual, we could speak different languages like Gujaratis and Marathi and Hindi and stuff.
Yes.
And it was quite challenging. And 3 years we spent in Bombay was. Well, I would say probably the best days of my schooling days.
I see.
And all three of us like that. I got my younger sister and younger brother.
Right, right.
We never wanted to leave Bombay and come to Bangalore.
Ah.
That was the kind of attachment to the city.
I see.
It was wonderful. So I think one of the good things which exposed me at that point in time was going to Bombay was, how do you tackle with different people from different background, different culture.
Right, right.
Adapting yourself to that was a key factor.
Yes.
So I was nine and a half when we went to Bombay.
Wow.
So our language was different. Bombay people would speak a completely different language.
Mm.
So for us, we had to learn completely different language. Schooling was a lot different. The schooling did have different languages for us to learn, which had Marathi and stuff. We didn't know Marathi.
Mm.
So we had to learn that as part of our schooling. So obviously it encouraged us to learn the other side of the fence, the other side of the things, which is different language, different culture, and all those sort of things.
Wow.
You do have the mainstream subjects like mathematics and stuff, which is fine, whether you go to Bombay or Bangalore or anybody else, it's still the same thing. But the language is a tough thing to keep learning.
We
were exposed to that.
All right.
And that kind of challenged your ability to kind of adapt yourself to different circumstances.
That's
I think that played a key role when I actually came to Australia as well, because when I actually arrived here for my master's, you had to kind of mix yourself with different people, because you had to form groups and how do you mingle. So we had international exposure. Now at that time it was all national exposure, but here it's like we had students from Pakistan, we had students from China.
Yes.
So I did projects with all of them.
I see.
And I think that was a little bit of a learning which I could take from my schooling days to my master days here, which, you know, you can connect it.
Yep.
How you can really get to know each other by, you know, by knowing their culture and back, because it really makes a good strong group that you want to work with.
Definitely.
So if you're very reserved and you want to be in your own comfort zone, then you really can't build that relationship.
Yes.
So I think somewhere down the line, it really helped me.
Yes.
Even today in our business as well, like for us, we interact with different kinds of client and everything. So it's the ability for you to kind of make yourself very comfortable in different group,
yes,
is something very important.
Yeah.
And I think that's what I found, you know, like since my dad's role was more on traveling, it kind of different people, different culture, different dialect,
yes,
and different kind of food and stuff. So that was a good exposure for us.
Wonderful. Yeah. Thank you so much. And I understand that you guys are blessed with wonderful parents.
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah. Can you name me some features, like what wonderful parents or good parents?
Oh, yeah, sure. I definitely. I mean, I think this is something I think is paramount to any children or any child.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of hard to define what good parents or definition of good parents.
Yes.
But for me, for us, my father was always there for any kind of advice, any kind of help, any kind of assistance.
Mm.
And there was no element of fear. They were so open for anything we did.
Right.
But though they kind of guided us at the right point in time of what's right, what's wrong, and all those sort of things.
Yes.
But there was never a point where they could, you know, just say, look, I'm imposing something on you.
Uh-huh. I see.
There was never a question of something being imposed on us.
Right.
To all three of us, myself, my sister, and my brother.
Mm.
My mother would literally dedicate, like she didn't go to work, and she was she's a housewife.
Yes.
So obviously she sacrificed her growth in terms of going out or fetching a job or anything like that. So
yes.
My mother was always there with all three of us.
Mm.
And my father would obviously work.
Yeah.
The best thing about my father was he was a friend, he was a guide, he was a mentor, and you could confide him in,
mm.
confide in my father,
mm-hmm.
regardless what you've done.
Ah.
You know, like I was in my engineering. I would like to recall these moments where I actually failed in one of the subjects.
Uh-huh.
It was very tough, and I was quite disappointed.
Yeah.
And usually when you call your parents, they're saying that you failed in a subject. The you'd expect them to yell at you, scream at you, and scold you and stuff.
Right.
But I remember I called my dad and said, look, I've lost the subject in my second semester of my engineering.
Mm-hmm.
And my dad said, look, you know, that's fine, what has happened. why don't you go for a movie and come home,
I see.
And we'll catch up in the evening.
Right.
He was not casual about my education. He was very serious.
Yes.
He had put all his money and faith in me and stuff.
Yep.
But somehow he could say, look, he made us feel that, look, it's very important for you to strive and do the right thing. And no point screaming and shouting at you and imposing things.
Right.
And he kind of, I think, very in a very subtle way, made us feel very responsible, very accountable of ourselves.
Mm.
That was an element which you know, we lost him in 2006.
No, sorry.
And so that's one. I mean, I was another thing I want to say is I was 9 and a half or 10, and I had smoked a cigarette.
Mm.
And my family, I mean, because I was playing cricket with all elderly people, so the exposure was that they used to smoke cigarette, and it was like as a child.
The main thing to do. Huh?
And they put the cigarette in my mouth, and I smoked a cigarette.
Yeah.
So my mother kind of identified that I had smoked, and she informed my father.
Uh-huh.
And my father, you know, he went to a cigarette shop, and he was completely a teetotaler. He then got the cigarette, explained me what gets into a cigarette, how cigarette is manufactured, what's tobacco, what's a filter in a cigarette.
Yeah.
What are the downsides? What are the side effects of smoking cigarette and all those sort of things?
Yes.
Very patiently to someone who was 9 and a half year old child.
Yes.
And saying, look, these are all the bad things of smoking.
Mm.
And he said, look, if at all you want to do, you know, if you want to smoke, then you can smoke in front of us. We don't want you to kind of go run away and do things behind our back.
Yeah.
For a 10-year-old to get that from his parents was a big thing, and that was probably the last time I smoked cigarettes. So it was very open in that way. So he would educate us on what's right, what's wrong. He would just bring the information, and he would give you that wisdom of what's right, wrong for you.
Right.
So, and And that was very important. You know, he never said, you know, you've got to be doing this, you've got to be doing that, this will give you a better income, this will give you... He would let us do what we want to do. And I was, since I mean, I've tried a lot of things. I tried my... I wanted to be a cricketer, I wanted to be a musician. I tried quite a bit of diverse things, which my, you know, traditionally from our family, they won't probably get into it.
Yeah.
But he was always there for us. And so my mother was full of ambition, and she wanted us to like do well in commercial life and everything. And she would bring that desire, the aspiration, by giving examples like, you know, look at your uncle, look at, and she would bring those examples to kind of make us more competitive. But my dad would give that confidence, like, look, no matter what you do, you will do well for yourself. He was that kind of a, and he would, for some reason, he would bring that faith which you could not see. You know, you just say, no, you will do well in your life. And you might have got very poor marks in your tests or anything, but he would still say, no, you will do well. So when you kind of keep putting that faith back into your children, somewhere it tries to bring the best, because I was very ordinary when it comes to my education. I'm not saying I was number one or number two. Yes, I had my own good days of high school. I was quite good, but then when I played cricket, I couldn't really concentrate that much on education, so it obviously slipped down.
Yes,
but I was sharp as a child, but I'm not a bookworm, so I would not go and read for 15 hours in 24 in 15 hours a day, and literally I'm someone who's like will take the gist out of it and implement my own thing.
Right.
So, but then because he kind of gave me all those opportunities, even when I actually arrived in Australia, and that was a completely free thing, and I like I could go and test what I want to.
Yep.
And that's where the entrepreneurial thing started for me, because I knew, okay, this is the early part of my life, and I have to really earn well.
Yeah.
So I can't go wrong in earning.
Yeah.
But I know, okay, at the end of the day, my father is there for me to take this challenge.
Yes.
And my family was very supportive.
Yeah.
I guess for any entrepreneur, one of the important things is you need to have your family backing you.
Yeah.
And in my case, just not my parents, I think even my wife and my brother, they have played a key role in all these things happening today.
Exactly.
So I think whatever the share of success I've had, I think I would attribute everything back to my family especially. Yeah.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. Thank you. Now the next thing is let us talk about the cost effectiveness. Like, how do you micromanage it in such a efficient way, you know, and then at the same time still being able to be so innovative?
I think, you know, I read somewhere where you can only be a leader if you innovate. And change is the only constant. And if you kind of get stuck in what everybody else is doing, you'll be left behind. And this is something which is I guess is a common sense.
Yeah.
So in any field, we have to think of how to bring that innovation, because then that gives you an edge. And it gives you, it lets you kind of get further up in your pursuit of expansion.
Yeah, I see.
But if you lack innovation, then I don't think so, you'll survive for too long. You can still be there, but you will not be, you cannot aspire to be a leader in any game. And if you look at any large companies, and they always have innovated. I mean, the massive success only comes when you kind of bring the innovation, when you kind of bring your own element to this world. So I think innovative was always there. And as I always thought, if everybody is doing and I do the same thing, then there's no which way. Why should client choose us? You know, why should they work with us? So innovative thoughts, ideas, was something imperative. There was no alternative but to be innovative.
Yep.
So that needs to, I mean, that's not just us. I think it's any company. I mean, if you look at number of call centers and stuff like that, they've just stuck to one thing and they've not innovated. And you see 2 years or 3 years down the line, they're no longer there in business.
Right.
So you'll see the spike happening.
Yes.
And they've done well and they've, made some money. But eventually, if you see 3 or 4 years down the line, the business no longer exists. So I think innovativeness is very important.
Yes.
It's extremely important. Now being efficient, and this is something which I was I learned while I was doing COPC certification when I was working for a company in India.
Mm-hmm.
And it said, a lot of times, when you actually are building building an organization or building a company, it is very important for you to make everyone accountable and everyone efficient.
Mm-hmm.
There's no point having multiple layers of hierarchy just to show it. You know, it's good, you know, like we have COO and
yeah.
we have, you know, we have CFOs and we have, you know, operations managers, you know.
Yeah.
They, we can have 101 title. At the end of the day, what's important for someone to, this is my belief, I might be wrong here, but I strongly believe for you to run anything efficiently and effectively, you need to know things from one end to the other end.
Mm.
So the way how this happened was, I was good in telemarketing.
Yep.
So I learned telemarketing. Then eventually I became a team leader. I've seen that growth. I became then a sales manager. Then I became an operations manager. Then I became an operations director.
Mm.
So I had that series of growth of from scratch to the top.
Yes.
So I realized that for you to really know and teach someone or mentor someone or guide someone or train someone, you need to know that properly.
Mm.
So to build a self-funded company, you know, like it's sometimes you can afford to have different compartments, different departments when you bring capital into business.
Yes.
So when you can say, I've got the right planning team, I've got the good financial team, and we've got a great strategy, and you got 5 million or 10 million in your account, and you can implement those things.
Yep.
But imagine you have to start from scratch where you have nothing,
mm-hmm.
nothing but your talent.
Yes.
So then you start saying, well, how do I make it work? Because there's no other alternative for you,
mm.
and nobody's going to invest in you because you're no one.
Yep.
And I'm not a Harvard graduate. I'm not a, you know, I'm not from any established schools where they'll just give you money. So for me, the only thing was, okay, whatever you've learned while working with somebody else, can you implement the same thing in a much better, efficient way? That was the way to start the business.
Yeah.
So when we started, it was just my family members and my friends who were my employees.
Yes.
And then because we did that efficiently, we were doing it ourselves.
Yeah.
So we hired those people who are of the same frequency, who would do exactly what we're doing,
yeah.
if not to 100%, to 95, 96, or that. And we would monitor them on a religious basis of they making sure that they are doing those things.
I see.
So that was very important for us.
Right, right.
So we made sure that they're doing it. And once they did that,
mm-hmm.
you know, like they say, like, you know, you have to learn.
Yep.
Three things, my apologies. You have to learn yourself. Then you have to teach what you've learned.
Yeah.
And then you have to implement. You have to make sure it's implemented properly.
Right.
So so it was very important for us to learn ourselves.
Yep.
So once we've learned, then we got to hire the right person to make sure we teach them the right practices we've had ourselves.
Yes.
And then that practice is actually implemented. So you keep monitoring to make sure that
right.
it's happening and it's kind of getting across to other employees.
Yes.
So that was the trick. So here, everybody we have here, they multitask.
Yep.
They're all across multiple issues they are into. And it is quite hard because look, initially the business and small business starts around, it's people driven business.
Yep.
So it's driven by people.
Yep.
But as you start having more and more profit coming into the business, then you start putting process around that people.
Yep.
So, but it's initially people because you don't have money for process. Process would take softwares, would take systems and all. So you don't have that capital.
I see.
So the only way you can do it is by hiring the right people.
Mm.
So that's very important for you. The only way you can go right or wrong is by having right or wrong people.
I see.
So whether it's, when I say people, it also includes clients.
Right.
Do you work with the right client? Do you work with the right vendors? Do you work with the right employees? Do you work with the right staff? Having to work with that right set of people makes, because a lot of things I might not have it,
yeah.
but I know, like in our thing, like I don't have a lot of patience, but I know my brother who has got huge patience. So he would give that focus, which I cannot give. I would innovate something. I would give it to him. Then he will carry on.
I see.
So I've got my friend here as well. I've got my wife. So I know their strengths and need not be that all the strength is just with me. That's not the case. So I know what best I can do,
yeah.
and I know what best they can do, and in that way we kind of delegate and share things amongst ourselves.
I see.
So having efficiency is wanting to make sure that we push everybody to the tune that that they innovate their own best is very important.
Right.
So I think we work here very closely to make sure that we identify their strengths.
Oh, I see.
And we let them play on the strengths.
Right.
That is very important.
I see.
To of knowing people of what their strengths are.
I see.
And how to capitalize
so,
their yeah. their stronger positive points.
Okay, does it mean that the people here have more freedom to say what they want to do?
Absolutely, yeah.
Ah, okay.
They have to have that freedom because
mm-hmm.
we don't want to be enforcing saying, you know, like somebody doesn't want to be on calls.
Mm-hmm.
We can't push them to be on calls because they won't do well.
Right, right.
So like we have people here, we have a guy here called Andrew and he's extremely good when it comes to compliance.
I see.
He's extremely knowledgeable.
Mm.
But he's not someone who's very comfortable on calls.
I see.
You know, he would pick those gaps which others want.
Uh-huh.
So we would use him in something which is very different,
yeah.
Which is compliance and training and all those sort of things.
Mm-hmm.
But we know, so, you know, the other guys on the floor, whoever is doing whatever they're doing, it's very important they're enjoying
yeah.
what they're doing, very importantly. And secondly, they're productive there.
Yeah.
So it is very important for us to identify where that strength lies.
Yeah, I see.
So some people are good talking to residential customers, some people are good talking to commercial customers.
Right.
So, and they're different skills, they're not the same skills.
Yes.
Now when you talk to a doctor, it's very different. When you talk to an accountant, it's very different. When you talk to a businessman, it's very different because they all have their own,
yeah.
pros and cons. So it's very different for how you kind of tune yourself to different kinds of businesses.
Yes, thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. Okay, the other thing I had to revisit is about the offshoring, the level of offshoring. Yeah, how do you define, you know, how do you draw a line?
Yeah. Well, as Thought World, we've ensured we have to define every category of business we do.
Yes.
Our work here predominantly is voice-based work, so mm-hmm. just telephonically done. So we talk to customers.
Mm-hmm.
It's more live. Yes. Now we made an internal policy that any voice-based process we will not offshore.
I see.
And it's not because something's wrong doing offshoring. There's nothing wrong. At the end of the day, it's left to every company to decide what's right or wrong for them.
Yes.
For us, we, when it comes to serving, and our clients are predominantly, we only have Australian clients, we don't have clients beyond this country.
Mm-hmm.
So Australians in general prefer, whether it's customer service, whether it's sales, whether it's anything, the first preference for them is to talk to live operators.
Yes.
They don't want to talk to a machine. They don't want to talk to someone who is miles away.
Yeah.
And there's a reason, there's a subtle thing which is very hard for us to go and teach or mentor people offshore. There's nothing wrong with people in Philippines or India or any of the offshore countries.
Yes.
But importantly, it's very hard for someone to understand what is the culture in Melbourne, what's the culture in Sydney, or how's the weather here. And you can
yeah.
read stuff, but reading and feeling and talking are very different things, right?
Yes, yes.
So when we have someone calling us and talking to us, we want someone to talk to them in the same frequency.
Yeah.
So we want to give that best feel to the customer. We don't want the customer to have, oh, look, where have I called? These guys don't understand. I can't communicate. So we don't want that thing. And we often have found that, especially our campaigns, when it's outbound campaigns especially,
mm-hmm.
The results are far more better
right.
when you do it here. And the reason why I say is, it might be slightly cheaper going to the, probably more cheaper going to the countries like India or Philippines. But at the end of the day, if you look at the penetration
yeah.
of 10 calls turning into one sale or 100 calls turning into one sale,
mm.
because you're burning that much amount of data.
Yes.
Today the industry is getting smaller and smaller.
Yeah.
People have to not call, register to opt out.
Mm-hmm.
And there's plenty of above the line marketing is done. People don't want to be bombarded.
Yes.
With something which they don't want to hear.
Right.
So you don't have that much, considering Australia has got very limited population. It's not in billions and millions like America and India and China. You have very limited data.
Mm.
So you have to make sure that numbers or that data is not burnt excessively,
mm.
but trying to bombard customers with plenty of phone calls.
Yes.
So whatever is relevant, you have to go with something which will make them feel happier, which will be value add for the customers and stuff. So we are very conscious about how many calls we make
yeah.
and what is the conversion of those calls.
I see.
So that's one of the reasons, considering those number of other factors, because cost is one factor, but cost is not the only factor.
Mm.
What's your penetration? How you're reaching out to the customers? And how you're burning the thing. You won't know all these things if you don't think in a large, big way. So for us, that's the key factor. So we don't want to burn, we don't want to frustrate, we don't want to tarnish or jeopardize our name. Yep. So all the clients we work with, we're very conscious about, you know, how many times we call the customer and what is a conversion and are they happy and they're not happy. Others, you know, those things are very important for us. You know, just not making money. Making money is one side, but also the overall satisfaction of the customer and the field is very important. And that's why our clients love us, because we are very methodical about what we do.
Right. Thank you very much. I'd like to talk about the trend now. Thanks for telling us about how it evolves from door to door, because you guys are in the acquisition solution business.
Yeah.
And right now Australia is developing into a online and retail.
Absolutely. Yeah. I think there are many segments of acquisition. At the end of the day, door to door was one of the very powerful channels, and a lot of energy companies and telecommunication companies use door-to-door.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, over the last 12 months, that segment of acquisition is not doing well, and ACCC has fined few companies, and it is currently under a lot of scrutiny.
Right.
So it's microscopically looked into at the moment.
Yeah.
So I think that industry is going through a bit of a reformation,
or
a restructure. I'm not too sure whether it will really be revived or not revived. So I think that one thing is unfortunately out.
Yeah.
It's not kind of growing that well, to be frank with you.
Yes.
The second segment is telesales.
Yep.
And I guess. There'll be, I think in the future that there may be some regulations coming to tighten up telemarketing as well.
Right.
Though it's a lot more tighter when it compared to door-to-door, because you can monitor what's being said, how it's going across to the customers and everything.
Yes.
But still, I guess there'll be still some implications and some developments happening on telemarketing side of things, and. Online is something which has grown over the last few years.
Yes.
And if you look at the success of a lot of online large companies, whether you look at car sales, whether you look at Seek, whether you look at the real estate companies and a lot of those things, online in Australia is growing because of the younger population and the people are more internet savvy.
Yeah.
And I guess that's where it'll go.
Yes.
That's the big market.
Yep.
And as ThoughtWorld, we've taken our initiative in launching three new brands into online. We partnered with some established companies to support us in this venture.
Yeah.
And I'm very positive that it'll head in the right direction.
Yes.
It's a very, very innovative and a very attractive way to reach out to customers.
Yes.
Because you're not forcing yourself. They actually are looking for themselves.
Yeah.
And nobody is trying to influence the decision, because they have the liberty, the freedom to kind of make the choice of their own.
Right.
So, and then retail is growing as well, because a lot of companies are now, if you look at number of shopping centers, they're having their own small kiosk and that's a time when they're kind of free, they're open, they have a lot of time on hand and they want to shop around of what's best for them.
Yes.
I think retail is opening up and so that's there as well.
Yep.
And the last way is above the line marketing, which is there since ages, whether it's billboards or advertising or sponsoring footy clubs or anything there. That's anyways there, and a lot of big companies too. But for smaller companies, they can't go above the line. They can't go to TV or spend hundreds and thousands of dollars.
Yes.
Smaller companies would always be around, like online or probably retail.
I see.
Online is a good strategy, because then you can try small scale and see how it is kind of penetrating.
Yes.
So I think online is probably the most attractive amongst everything we're trying out at this point in time.
Okay. Thank you very much. Now, the other thing is for young people coming to Australia, I understand that you say that there are a lot of software development opportunities.
Yeah.
So actually, this question really want to focus on that. What is so advantageous here in Australia? Wouldn't it be better if they go to Asia, where software development can come at a lower cost?
I think there are two sides. I mean, I can only answer from See, the two sides to this question. One is, do you want to come to Australia wanting to seek a job?
Uh-huh.
Or do you want to come to Australia to try something of your own?
I see.
If you want to come to Australia thinking, yes, there's better lifestyle here,
mm-hmm.
Compared to you know, Asia,
yes.
In the sense it's whether it's better roads or you know, all the amenities here are much better.
Yes.
So it gives you, yes, better lifestyle.
Yes.
But you cannot say that you will get better job prospects in
yes.
Australia
yeah.
compared to Asia.
Yes.
Whether you look at China, whether you look at India,
yeah.
The amount of companies and the amount of development happening because of the exposure China and India has to Western countries, which includes UK and US, who are far more ahead in
yeah.
terms of the technology, the development and all those sort of things. The companies are literally are based in those countries, whether it's China or India.
Yes.
They literally are there for you.
Yes.
And the production is happening in billions and billions.
Exactly.
That's definitely not there in Australia.
Yeah.
And there might be some niche jobs here, but you know, compared to the scale what happens in India and China,
exactly.
I don't think so. Australia can even match it in the next 10, 20 years, to be honest. It's
yes.
just not there,
yes.
from my understanding.
Yes, I agree with you on that.
There's a huge avenue and opportunity when it comes to these countries. If they're growing countries, even Indonesia, for example, if
yes.
you look at the growth, it's magnificent.
Yeah.
So we cannot say the Asian countries, job prospects would be better here than those countries. So I think if you want to be a good professional and you want to look out for opportunities, probably
uh-huh.
you don't need to come here.
I see. Right.
I would not say so from my experience.
Right, right.
Because I think there are more job prospects there, and the better the universities are as good as probably here, or probably better as well, because it is a quite competitive. When I come from India and I looked at IITs and stuff, I couldn't get through to IIT, so it's a lot more harder to get through to IITs and stuff.
Yes.
So I think when you look at, if you answer me on that, probably no. I would not suggest you to come here in pursuit of a job, unless until you have something you know exactly. Australia is the only country which has that kind of a niche
yes.
prospect. In general, if you ask me, well, countries like Asian countries are
mm.
have more to offer than here.
Yes.
But if you want to ask me from an entrepreneurial perspective,
uh-huh.
well, you want to start a business out of India, how easy it is,
mm.
and how easy it is for you to start a business out of Australia.
In that
aspect, I would say Australia is easier.
I see.
Because it's systematic.
Right.
So if you want to set up a business, it takes you 3 minutes. Go to ASIC and just register
mm.
a business name. And in 2 minutes, literally 2 minutes, you can have your own business name. You can be, yeah, you can just get started. You can open up the bank account in just 5 minutes.
Yep.
And you can, and there you go. You know a client. You want to do something. You can talk to them, and you can have your first
yep.
client on board in a matter of minutes.
Yep.
However, once you get that ball rolling.
Mm.
The question what challenges you in Australia is sustainability and scalability.
Right.
So you get that inertia
mm-hmm.
to start easily in Australia.
Yes.
But sustaining and growing that is a big challenge here.
Yes.
Compared to Asia.
Mm.
Asia is harder to start.
Right.
Because of the bureaucracy and the government policies where by the time you register, it would take 6 months. By the time you get the bank account and all the logistics and stuff,
yes,
it is time consuming.
Right.
Here, there's no red tape. You don't have to go on, you know, knock doors 50 times to get one license. You would get it
yeah.
If you have a right plan and whatever it is, then you just get it here.
Yes.
It just doesn't take a while. But once you get things started here,
mm-hmm.
what is challenging for you here is sustaining it and growing it. For the reason why it happens is the labor cost is too high in Australia. The compliance is too high.
Yeah.
The regulations are extremely tight.
Yes.
So you managing all three and still growing would be a massive challenge. You know,
yes.
I would doubt if the largest companies, you know, sitting here would not have that scalability here in Australia, because you need to have. Now, you know, you need to have people
yep.
and you don't find that many because obviously less population, so less avenue for you to get
yeah.
everything, you know.
Yes.
So it's limited. So you have to work within that limits.
Right.
So you have to be very careful of choosing what you want to do.
Mm.
and growing, or growing quickly or growing faster would have all these elements taken into consideration.
Mm-hmm.
That's why I say growing in Asian countries is scalability is a much easier factor there, because
yes.
I run business in India,
yeah.
and I've run here as well.
Yeah.
And we grew pretty quickly in 3 years from almost 10 staff to 400 staff. Right. Now, for us to do, we've grown here as well,
mm.
but the growth rate, you know, we've grown from 5 to 100, but there was like 10 to 400. So that's the difference we're looking here.
Yes.
So that's where it is very important for us to see the strengths of what offers what.
Yeah.
You know, to get started, probably Australia is great.
Yes.
But then, what is the rate of growth you want to get?
Right.
How big you want to become? All those things you need to kind of
yes.
you know, do a proper business plan and but some of the advice, you know, if I could contribute here is you got to, you know, starting here is definitely easy because it's more systematic,
yeah.
but surviving and sustaining and
mm.
growing
mm.
is quite challenging here.
Yes. Yeah, thank you. Yeah. Thank you very much for that answer. The last thing is I would say you are the right person to ask this question because you have done, you know, so much in such a, you know, such short amount of time, and you know you are very visionary. So, two pieces of advice: one for Australian entrepreneurs and corporations, the industry, and one for the young people in Australia. Because what I see right now, what we see is on the high street, shops are closing down. If you walk to Bridge Road, you know, fashion stores are closing, and if you now open up the newspapers, the headlines are there, all the, you know, ANZ, Ford, you know, either they downsize or they, you know, do redundancy. So what is, you know, the way forward now?
I'm not too sure if I can advise anybody there or not. I don't have that much of expertise and experience, but what I actually have figured out in my last few years of experience in business is you really have to understand
mm.
where is, what's your cost?
Mm-hmm.
And what's your revenue?
Mm-hmm.
Where's your revenue income coming from? And with cost increasing, any business surviving in this country gets harder and harder.
Yes.
Especially small size businesses.
Right.
So business like us would face that heat
mm-hmm.
than anybody else.
Yeah.
So you have to, if the gap between the revenue and cost is reducing.
Yes.
Then it's a sign of concern. So we need to figure out what is the alternative way of generating revenues.
Yeah.
So that's where you say efficiency comes into play. If you're not having the right skilled, efficient people,
mm.
and that's why every employee here, we have a KPI. Is that guy productive by the end of the day? And how often you measure?
I see.
Now you don't want to be measuring 5 months down the line where you realize you're minus $100,000.
Yes.
You know, that it's then it's too hard for you to turn
right.
and turn things. So that's why we see micromanagement in small business is very important.
Mm.
Because your process is not managing, you're still managed by people, you're not managed by process.
Right.
Till the time process can take over people, you know.
Yes.
The reason what I would like to give or share here is, I don't want to give any advice, but I'm happy to share, is you need to really measure the output
mm.
of every single employee of your company.
I see.
As frequently as you can.
Right.
So that you're not going wrong.
I see.
Because even if you're one person leaking every day, in next 12 months it will cost you a bump show.
Yes.
So that is why you say, measure, you know, keep measuring, keep measuring, and make sure keep pushing them to higher efficiency.
Yes.
Because that's the only way to drive
right.
business. So I would just be very mindful of your costs, because costs can really, within months, can change the whole dynamics of the game.
Yep.
And you need to have, and you have to bring innovativeness. And that's why I said different ways to reach out customers, different skills to, you know, market yourself is very important.
Yes.
You can't get stuck with one thing.
Okay.
So I don't know much about the retail industry, but if you know, if you say the shops are shutting and all those sort of things, then the only way they have to figure out is, like, you know, how can they reduce the cost, you know?
Mm.
What is our other way of reaching our customers? Probably online, or, you know,
yes,
get there without even having a lot of inventory. If they can just have
mm.
something which they can showcase and attract the customer's interest, And you know, it's easier said than done, but something has to be done there to stop business going bust, you know.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
So you got to be very mindful, and for the students coming or people coming from outside, I say Australia is a great country.
Yes.
There's a lot of opportunity in terms of what you can do.
Yes.
But at the end of the day, all boils down to you. So it's us who kind of look at anything and make it happen. So we have to be the right one to make a choice. We can't keep blaming. And the worst thing to do is, you know, keep blaming at the country, the place, people.
Yes.
Yeah, that's the worst thing one can do for themselves.
Yes.
So we got to figure out what we need to do.
Right.
And I see that there is definitely opportunity here in terms of starting businesses.
Mm.
And you can definitely expand. You know, you can start something here, but you can have connections in New Zealand, you can have connections in Asian countries and grow there.
Yes.
So I think, look, you have to think globally.
All right.
And you have to act locally. So it's very important.
Yes.
To kind of have that, message and grow. Yeah.
Right. Okay. One last short question. For those who are looking for jobs, it's getting harder and harder. This is something that sometimes, you know, we try to help our university, college students. So how do they get the job they want, right, in this competitive, you know, market? Less jobs, more people looking for jobs.
Yeah, true. True. I think, you know, I've gone through that a bit of it. Look, when I passed out, it was 9/11, and all jobs were deferred, and we didn't have anything to get into. And it was hard time. So I initially, when I came to Australia, there was such a hard time for us to get the job.
Yes.
So I think because the influences and the leaders and things I've read and was inspired,
yeah,
the best way for me was to start something of my own.
I see.
And I think creating employment was the more challenging thing for me than, you know, what I mean, I did work for someone for a short time, but eventually he said, look, why don't we try on my own? See, I really don't have the right answers for it, because I really don't know what is the, I know the unemployment rate ratio,
yeah,
is like, it's percentage has just kind of gone high,
yeah,
and stuff like that. But I haven't gone and searched whether what's the best way to kind of get the job.
I see.
So probably I'm the wrong person to answer that question. But I think Asian countries have more offerings than here.
I see.
Amount of, you know, you can, I keep talking to my friends in other parts of the country and stuff like that. When I look at the job opportunities when it comes to India and the Asian countries especially,
yeah,
is so
high.
And that's one of the reasons, is because everybody wants to go there.
Mm.
They want to invest there because they're sure of the returns.
Yes.
Whether you look at real estate, whether you look at the multinationals,
yes,
including the likes of Microsofts and everything, if you, they have their offices in Asian countries. Why? Because they know the fact that the labor is cheap.
Yes.
The output is extremely good. There's massive talent.
Yes.
Scalability is not a problem.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of merits there, you know. Like,
yes.
And developing countries want to make policies friendly to the investors, like outside investors, because they want to make sure that the young crowd gets the right opportunity. And I think, which is not, you know, I'm not saying Australia as a country is making right or wrong policies, but if you look at, it's a developed country.
Yes.
And they would not want to twist things to change anything. It's already doing well for itself.
Yep.
So I think in that way, I think job prospects wise, probably, I think looking at some other countries would be a lot more easier than here.
I see.
Because I really don't know much about it, so I would not be the best person to answer it.
Right.
But the best way to get any job is to kind of, you go to market yourself in the best possible way.
I see.
Yeah, so.
Thank you.
I don't know if I've answered your question properly or not, but
I
really don't know what is the way to kind of get the...
I think what you say is very true. Marketing yourself, you know, creatively and all that. Yeah, so thank you so much for your time.
Thanks,
really,
Ben.
Appreciate that.
Pleasure.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you
so much. Yeah.